איש האחד למד תבואי סוף תשלחו כל נעשי בהם. יש לנו בזה בדרך רמז. הנה ידוע כי הקדוש ברוך הוא ימצא סוי למעין ליש, והם בחינס מחשובה, בחינס מייסה ודיבר. So הקדוש ברוך הוא created everything out of nothing. And there's three bechinas of creation, just like in a human being, it's called machshuva, dibur, and ma'aseh. Those are three levels of manifestation. Asher hem misogim and mergoshim. Uzeh bedvar Hashem shemayim nasu, asiyeh hoyim midibur, v'hovin. So, when we look at the world, for us, we say that when we interact with the gashmi, we call it a ma'aseh. Because we ourselves are temporary, and therefore, when we're creating movement, and the Gashmi is the world that is similar to us, we call it a Maiseh, like something physical, something manifested. But if you look mitzad HaKadosh Baruch Hu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is stable, he's permanent, he's always the same. So, as far as he's concerned, anything that's under time is like a thought, is like speech. So what's the difference to us between speech and the physical? That speech is there for a moment and then it's gone. So when we talk, we create concept, the mind understands it, and then the words evaporate, they disappear. So legabe HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when we look at life, when we look at Olam HaAsiyah, it's the same thing. There's time moving, and everything is coming and going, everything is disappearing. And if we look at the world, if we look at the world as a globe over thousands of years, we can see this for ourselves. Every generation that existed, even though while they were existing, they thought that they were acting within HaAsiyah, they were doing stuff, but what they did is all gone. It came and it went, it came and it went. The permanency of what they did is in the Olam Ruchni, is in the changes that were in the development of man, and the changes that were in the conception of life and understanding life. So this is where the real creation is happening, not on the physical level, but on the spiritual level where we're creating man. We're creating a creature over here that the future generations are going to have access to and are going to experience, just like we experienced what the previous generations prepared for us. It's not the physical side of things. The physical side of things will always come and go. Even if you build something that seems like a permanent structure, it's only a matter of time until it's going to disappear. And the ancients are very familiar with this, and therefore they also, sometimes when they wanted to build spiritually, when they built for spiritual purposes, they built in a way that won't be, that it won't fall apart for many years to come. Like we see the pyramids, there's a lot of machlokes about the exact age of the pyramids, but those people built in a way that it should be like a spiritual structure. It should have some permanency. It should be able to talk to future generations for thousands of years. So this is one bechin of understanding how bedvar Hashem shemayim nasi. What does it mean when we say that the physical is the words of HaKadosh Baruch Hu was created with words? It means that mitzad HaKadosh Baruch Hu, physical is like words. It's an expression, it's a manifestation of concepts and ideas. And therefore, this perpetuates life. This is how life can continue. But the real permanency is within the soul, within the neshamas, within the beings that are being created, that are being defined. They have continuance and they build on top of the previous generations and it continuously goes forward. The other bechina is brought in the Sefer HaBohir. The Sefer HaBohir says, Bereshis Bara Elokim, which world are we talking about? We're talking about the Torah, which is the world of all worlds. Because the world, the physical, doesn't have meaning. So when we talk about the Olam, when we're talking about creation, what are we talking about? We're talking about creating the concept of man, creating the perception, creating the spiritual reality of man. And that was done through the Torah. The Torah created a spiritual structure that man can relate to and build himself up with. And this relates back to the shita of Reb Nachon Yevan HaKona, who wrote the Sefer HaBohir, that he also brings in Sefer HaTmuna, that the world has been going for longer than 6,000 years, but this form of speech that we have now, this is 6,000 years old. So when we talk about Adam Rishon, we're talking about the first conscious man that could speak the way that we speak. That's when the beginning of time starts, as far as Bereshis Bara Elokim. So Bereshis Bara Elokim, when man became conscious and he needed the world to live in, he needed concept and understanding in order to be able to interact with life. So this is how it came forward. This is how it happened. This is how it manifested into reality. And obviously it's a very deep allegoric language, which we're thousands of years removed from. And even those who lived thousands of years ago, they couldn't relate to it because of its depth. So it's tremendous depth. And they had secret societies in those times that would transfer over the wisdom from one generation to the other. Because the Amon Am, It was maybe even in worse shape than today. Most of them didn't know how to read or write, and they couldn't really relate to deep ideas. The language was in its infancy. It was starting to be developed. Civilization was in its infancy. And people realized that within civilization, wisdom, knowledge, understanding of how man works gives man too much power. It needs to be hidden. And therefore, there were secret societies. Some of them still have some remnants still today, but really, they all went, I think, approximately after Greece, when Greece turned into Rome. The Romans were extremely physical. The Greeks still had intellectual prowess. They still tried to understand. They still had secret societies. They still had deeper understandings of the wisdoms. And then Rome was all about conquering and fighting and physical bloodshed that they were into. And this is the extreme opposite of wisdom. This is at the other end of the spectrum. This is a type of behavior that removes all possibility of contemplating reality in its truest sense. And therefore, it was a downward spiral from there. And obviously, Western cultures today are built exactly on that. Even the alphabet that we have, which is the soul of a nation, the soul of a nation is its language. The alphabet that we have are called the Roman characters. That's what we use. We got these from Rome. These were, the Greeks took it from the Phoenician languages and from the Hebrew, which came from the same group of languages. Arabic is similar to Hebrew for that reason. And there are multiple cultures that came from that source, from that origin. The Greeks took those alphabets, turned it into their own. And this is where you have the alpha, the beta, and those characters that they used. And then the Romans converted that to more similar to the ABCs that we're familiar with, the alphabet that they use still in the Western cultures. So at that time is when wisdom disappeared from the map, when people started becoming extremely physical, started trying to accumulate things in order to feel better with themselves. And it was only a matter of time until we arrived to a point where people need to be medicated just to be willing to stay in their bodies. It's so painful for them to just live through the daily life, the daily task of staying alive, that they need medication just in order to keep their calm. And this is not to say anything bad about those people. It speaks to the society at large and our understanding of human nature and our ability to cater to the human being, which is the only reason there is a society. Society is only here to cater to human beings. There's no other purpose for having a society. So when society itself abuses the people for some other ideals that are not based on reality, that are not based on what's real and on real human nature and how a human being works, they cause tremendous problem. They cause tremendous disease. And this wisdom was not only the wisdom, but how the wisdom is going to proceed in time, and the ability for people to be able to contemplate this reality, this was foreseen by the Torah. And in that sense, the Torah already won. The Torah told us that if you're not gonna have access to the wisdom, life is gonna become horrible. And in that sense, the Torah was already right. The Torah already told us that truth. Now, we need to be able to gain access to the wisdom that they put away from us as an antidote to this disease, to this spiritual disease that we're suffering from. And this is the Torah. The Torah builds that world for us that human beings can actually live in. That's the purpose of it. That's the reason it's there. That's why it was given to us. So even though at times it looks like it's shoved down our throat by force, like Chazal teaches, kof aleim har kegigis, that's only because we're too stupid to take it by will. So it has to be shoved down our throat. But it's not because there's something there that's trying to take anything from us, adrabid. It's only here to give and to give and to give some more, to make our lives so tremendously joyful, so tremendously pleasurable, that whatever we had now, whatever we had till now, is just going to look like a bad dream, like a nightmare. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu manifested life the way that he did the physical. He later manifested concept, manifested realities within man, so that man can understand himself. V'chein baras ha'adam. The same thing, he created man. B'chinas neshama, chelek elekam emal. B'chinas ayin, sha'ina misik. So the person himself has also these sides to him. He has the ayin and the yesh. The ayin is the chelek ruchni, which is ayin. Where is the neshama? Nowhere. You can't see it, you can't feel it, you can't touch it. It's ayin. Mitzat sheini, this ayin, this nothingness, this thing that we can't relate to or perceive, is in charge of all the yesh. Because everything that happens, happens from the neshama. Nothing takes place without the neshama. And therefore, the ayin is in charge of the yesh. What seems to us to be nothing is in charge of everything that we think is important. So which means that the only thing that's really important is that nothing, is that ayin, which also can be switched the letters to ani, which is the self. The self, the nothingness, it's all the same. It's the source of being. Kedisa b'shas, ma'akadosh baruch hu roi v'eino nera, so the neshama is roi v'eino nera, because the neshama is not visible. The b'chun is gufnis, and then there's the other side of the human being, the physical side, the mergesh musig. That can be felt and touched. The k'shodah medabek atzim, b'chun is gufnis v'gashmis. If a person doesn't recognize his ayin, he doesn't recognize somebody in charge of his being, azai he mafrid atzim arasaychel shelo, he separates himself from wisdom, he separates himself from knowledge, from intelligence, because he is now engrossed in physical. He thinks he's just a body. And when a person thinks he's just a body, then he's separated from his reality. He doesn't have access to himself. That the chait means that a person is removed from his light, he's removed from his neshama. And that's why they say that a person's neshama runs away. And they say a person's neshama runs away is the same thing as saying, because a riach shtus is the opposite of the neshama. The neshama is a ruach of chochma, ruach of seichel. And the ruach shtus is when the neshama leaves and a person thinks he is just physical, and that's when he starts getting himself into complicated areas. So a person was manifested, like we spoke before, in the shape, in the form, b'tzelem elekim, which is the form of the big nature, the form of the big man. So everything has an entity that has the same formula as a human being, including if we look just at the solar system, or if we look at the full galaxy, if we look at all the galaxies, even planet Earth, which is a ball, Chazal somehow were able to chop up into different body parts to say that this is this body part and this is that body part. Like we say, the Torah calls Mitzrayim Ervas Aretz. So this is different parts of the human being, because the human being contains all the vibrations, all the frequencies of life. Otherwise, why would we need such a frequency if the human being can't interact with it in some form? So every part of the land correlates to some other body part, to some other frequency or vibration that a person could tap into. And this relates to the nations that are going to find that space suitable for their needs. And it relates to their philosophy, and it relates to their beliefs. It relates to everything that happens on that space, because the Mokoim is one of the places that is Goyim. So there's three things that are Goyim: Oilam, Shona, and Nefesh. So Oilam is the Mokoim, the space where things take place, that's Mashpia. Shona is the time that things take place, that's Mashpia, because each day has a different energy, different vibration. Even each hour, each moment, each second, each fraction of a second has its own uniqueness that comes once and it leaves and then it's gone. And whatever was done with it, that's its permanent color, that's its permanent flavor of how it came out to be. And then we have the Nefesh, which is obviously the person, which is Mashpia on how things take place and what type of vibration it's going to have and how it's going to feel and how it's going to manifest itself. So all three have Hashpa on what's happening. And if we look at just the human being himself, we can see this sort of, so we know the Sefer Yetzira separates the human body into three big portions, according to the letters Emesh. Emesh is the beginning, the middle, and the end of the letters. So the Aleph stands for Avir, for air. The Mem stands for Mayim, and the Shin stands for Esh. So when the Sefer Yetzira separates that into the bodily portions, it says the head is the fire, because that's where the consciousness is, that's where the Dibur is, that's where thought is. All these things relate to the fire element. And then we have the water element, which is the lowest, which is called the beten, and the reproductive organs, the part that processes the food, and the part that recreates, that's all part of the mayim. And then we have the aver in the middle, which is the gvia, which is the torso, where the heart lives, and the lungs, which take in the air in order to give a human being life. Now, if you look simply at the human being's face, you will see a representation of all these three, because the eyes represent the head, they represent the awareness, the ability to see, to perceive. And the nose represents the air. And this is why from the nose goes the air to the lungs, and it relates to the heart. And the mouth relates to the digestion and the reproduction. The digestion because we eat through the mouth, and the reproduction because we speak through the mouth. And just like speech is our spiritual creation, our reproduction is our physical creation. So you see how HaKadosh Baruch Hu creates everything with the same formulas. The formulas repeat themselves in the big and in the small, in the micro and in the macro. Every time we have the same formula recontinue itself. Why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu do it like that? To make it easy for man to understand what's happening, to make it intuitive. But we've done so many cheshbonos rabim outside of ourselves. We've gone so far from nature and created so many different complicated procedures, complicated texts, complicated understandings of life, that it's very difficult for us to come back to the simplicity of the intuitive nature of life and how HaKadosh Baruch Hu created it, so that we can understand ourselves, we can understand our body, and understand how consciousness resides within it. So a human being is a specimen of the entire universe. A human being contains within him all the different possibilities of manifestation, and therefore, he is the purpose of creation, because everything that was created has a place within the human. Everything that was created can be pointed within the human and saying, you know why it was created? Because this is what it does for the human being. That's why it needs to be here. So therefore, the human being is such a complex creature that has so many different things happening at any given moment. So when a person is in touch with that reality, so we would say he's in touch with his neshama, he's in touch with the real root of who he is, with the real ayin. The real ayin that he has, the real nothingness that runs him, correlates exactly to his being. But when a person goes into other functions of life, where he gets lost in the intricate details that were man-made, so then it's a ruach shtus, he's left his neshama, he's left reality, he's gone into a man-made structure that will eventually cause problems, because everything that goes out of balance has side effects. Everything that we do wrong has side effects, and these are the guardrails of HaKadosh Baruch Hu protecting humanity, so that if we go away, it hurts, so we go back. If it didn't hurt, we can just continue going away and away and away and away, and the purpose of life would get lost. But like this is how HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, that because I chose you, because I like you, because I want Klal Yisrael to be the family, the mishpacha that have access to my wisdom, Efkad alechem eskalav enesechem. Therefore, I'm going to punish you. So more punishment simply means a closer guardrail to keep us going on the right track. So others might have a bigger guardrail, so they can go many different directions and they won't feel the pain. But for Klal Yisrael, the guardrails are very close. As soon as we go off a little bit left or right, we get hurt right away. We start feeling the pain. And this caused us tremendous suffering over the history of our nation, and it continues to do so. But on the other hand, this is what's going to cause the tremendous good that's going to come out of it. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is choshev machshova is levilti yidach meni nidach, meaning before creation, he already had his plan of how he's going to create a reality where people cannot get lost. And this is how it's playing out. And the pain that we're feeling is the love of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The love of HaKadosh Baruch Hu that says, my son, this is not the way. This is not the way to do it. You have to rethink it. You have to look back. And this is only by rebuilding that world that HaKadosh Baruch Hu created through the Torah. That we can live in that reality, because that reality, that spiritual reality, organizes the ayin in a way that it actually correlates with the yesh. So to us, it's ayin. It's like, we don't even understand. What are you talking about? What do I need? What's broken? What's wrong? It's ayin to us. It's a roi vein and error. We don't see his problem. But the one who can see, the one who created, the one who understands, he says, follow this formula in order for you to be able to live in this reality. Because this correlates to that. One correlates to the other. This is how it was created. This is the purpose of what was, of what was done. So it says, V'chein k'shodim izdabik b'chol k'choysav l'b'chinas or sichloi, a person that's mevatel himself to his seichel, is mevatel himself to the intelligence within life, nasim izeh kol agufnim shio sichlim. So this moves the opposite direction. Before, he forgot. His rachshtus went in, he forgot himself, and now he's all physical. His seichel is not visible. It's serving the physical. It's in galus. But if a person is following his seichel, then the gufni becomes mevatel. There's no gufni. The gufni is just the glove holding the sichli. The gufni is just a marker saying this is the place that individual is standing in right now. But who's standing there? Not the guf. The one that's inside, the seichel, the intelligence, the ability to perceive and recognize. And therefore, all his physical becomes sichli. Kama tamid ha-chachomim. Like it says that when a person is a tamid chacham, that even a Sichas Chilin need limud. Why does a Sichas Chilin need limud? He's maskim right now that he's not busy with limud. So why are we arguing with him and saying, no, even this is limud? Because he is limud. He, his behavior, everything he does, everything he is one shtick limud, because he is manifesting reality the way that HaKadosh Baruch Hu intended it to be manifested. L'chein kol divrem kegach le'esh al heves, perish kol divrem v'eskeim agashmim, hem kshurim begecheles shu'or ha'seichel. Saying, everything they do is like gach le'esh, because they're never carrying a rock. When they do a physical, it's not like they're carrying something physical, they're doing something physical. They has the gach le'esh. What is the esh? The seichel, like we said before. The head is considered esh. The awareness is esh. So, kol divrem kegach le'esh. Everything they do with seichel. And therefore it's alive, it's burning. You can learn from that. You can light a fire from there. That Moshe Rabbeinu's madraiga was bigger than all the Nevi'im. It says, Pe'al pe'al da'aber boy, punim be'punim. What does that mean? That he didn't have to leave the physical like the others. So somebody might say, oh, look at those other people. The hispashtus agashmi is, their neshama went out, their body's just lying on the ground. Look at this holy madraiga that this person is on. Moshe Rabbeinu is just standing there. But Adarav, the Torah teaches us, no, that's the higher madraiga. If you can just stand there and recognize the truth as is while you're embodied fully, that's the highest madraiga. That means that your body is no longer bothering you from recognizing Ruchni. It's not standing in your way. It's allowing you to see through it. It's allowing you to recognize. And this is the purpose of creation. The purpose of creation wasn't that we should fall on the ground in order to perceive the truth. The purpose of creation was that we should be able to interact with the truth live as we live our lives. And this is what's going to happen when Mashiach comes, that people will be able to recognize the truth throughout the day, all the time, at any given point. Because when the truth will become clear enough, and the guf nizdachach enough, and the seichel will be big enough, and the guf won't be an hindrance, then everything becomes kodesh. Everything becomes a part of the seichel. Everything becomes a recognition of the truth. So therefore it says, so whatever a person does down here, whatever a person manifests, he's ma'oyrer in the oilam ha'seichel that this truth should become real now. So he's kevyochol making a change in his relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. HaKadosh Baruch Hu will now interact with him in a different format because he created the new sichli, he created the new understanding. So every moment we interact with HaKadosh Baruch Hu in a different way, in a different language. As we evolve, the language evolves, and our ability to interact with them becomes more real and more true. So through that, when a person lemato is misoider, miyached alufa shaloylem lebchinas yesh. Now, HaKadosh Baruch Hu went from ayin to yesh. How did he become a yesh? Because somebody is perceiving him in the physical realm. So when a person perceives HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he brings HaKadosh Baruch Hu out from the oilem of ayin into yesh. Like when a person is asleep, for example, we would say that his neshama is back to Bechinas Ayin. It's like it doesn't exist. There's no seichel there, there's nothing. His body is just laying there and it's in a vegetative state. It's like went back to being a tree. But when he wakes up, then the seichel comes out Ma'ayin Liyesh, because you see him speaking, you see him acting, you know, oh, his seichel is alive, his seichel is active, things are happening. So the same thing for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. When a person is Meyached Alifa Shiloylem in his heart, so then HaKadosh Baruch Hu is like he wakes up. He actually has a place in this world. He comes out Ma'ayin Liyesh. So once a person does that, even though he does it on the individual level, this wakes up the entire world, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is now within the world. So everybody within the world can feel HaKadosh Baruch Hu's presence, even though it might be unconscious. But when people will become more conscious, they will be able to actually see how that person awoke HaKadosh Baruch Hu within them. And this happened very often by tzaddikim in previous generations, that people would make tremendous effort to go be with them for Yontif. People would sometimes travel in the rain and in the mud for weeks or months just to see the Rebbe for 1 minute, for 1 day, for whatever it might be, because just recognizing that there's an individual like that, just looking at his tzura, would wake up within them an awakening of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, a recognition of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. They would realize something that they couldn't realize at home. And that made their trip worthwhile, because they understood how to be marich, how to give value to where value is due, to the spiritual, to things that happen within, to the experience, that's taking place. Because this experience, like we've spoken about many times, is what we take with us. The changes in our personality, we instantly take with us. The next day, we have a different personality to deal with. If he's nicer, it means that we're going to have a nicer time, an easier time living with him. So therefore, every change that we can have in our experience, every change that we can create within our personality, is a permanent kinyan that nobody can ever take away from us. And this is how Yidden could go through terrible, terrible pain, terrible suffering, and laugh at the people that were torturing them. Because they recognize something that those people didn't recognize, that every time they're being tortured, they're becoming pure, their personality is becoming more purified, more easily pleased, more ready to the midas rachmim, and the one who is perpetrating that act is now going to have to live with an even bigger achzer, with an even bigger, with an even more difficult personality, with an even more difficult reality. So the schar and the oynish are already taking place. So the yidden who had enough seichel, they could see it take place while it's happening, and they could laugh. They could laugh at the Nazis that are torturing them, because they understood the truth. They understood the ultimate truth. And obviously, a few years later, whoever the yid, whether he's here or anywhere else, he has his portion that he was koine. He has his midas toivus. He has the purification that he received. And the one that did whatever they did, they have to live with that. And they have to die with that, which is maybe even more difficult. So this reality was visible to the people who can understand it and appreciate it. And therefore, they lived life from a different perspective. They saw reality from a different place. They could interact with life from a much more comfortable seat, because they knew that the one who created it in a fair way, created it in the appropriate way. Once you understand how it actually works. There's no mistake. There's nothing that gets lost. There's nothing that happens in vain. Everything has a purpose. Everything plays out according to what was submitted, what was inputted. And it, nothing can leave the cheshbon keheref ayin, not even for 1 second. The cheshbon is continuous and steady, just like a person. His cheshbon of what he thinks next and what he says next and what he does next is keheref ayin. It always happens and it always works and it always includes what happened yesterday in it. The same way the world, the same way all the realities. Everything recalculates and re-updates every single moment. It's not like on your computer where you want to recalculate or reload and whatever and it starts turning. Life doesn't turn. Life happens. Every moment it happens, and we can watch this happen. We can see it happen because we are the ones happening. So when a person wakes up to a certain truth, he makes that truth available to the world, worldwide, instantaneously, and that's a new creation. Yesh me'ayin. V'zeh shleim shemiram zaposik. Ish echod ha'nik shodem oisel lamata. The person is miyachad himself to be ish echod. What does it mean, ish echod? Ish that has recognized the echod, ish that has recognized the yichud. Ha'ani shi b'chines echad sheloi, shi ayin, mechuber b'chines yesh sheloi, v'nas echod. Zeu ish. He says, even in the word ish, you can see this. Aleph yesh. That he brings the ayin, the aleph, the alifa sheloilam, into yesh. He makes him a yesh. That's what makes him an ish. That's what makes him a person, a human being. So through a person doing that, being meyachad as neshama, recognizing that there is a unity at work, so through that, he is me'ore that HaKadosh Baruch Hu should become like that. HaKadosh Baruch Hu should make himself available in that form, in that perception, in that understanding. That from there came all the different realities that we're interacting with. They all go back to a world of seichel. Before the world was created, the sichliyim of the world, the rules, the properties of how this is going to take place, how it's going to work, these exist in principle. They exist everywhere and they exist for eternity. So these principles, when they manifested, they created this world, they created this reality. So in the world of principle, we call that world of. The world of Seichel is called of. It's our father. Why? Because who shohele doisa, he gave birth to the physical realities from the world of sikhlim, from the world of principles, from the world of rules of how life is going to take place, of understanding the depth of what's real and how it works. From there came the world the way that it is. V'chulam v'chlal nikrom b'shem toldus la'ein sav baruchu. Everything is children. So even the sikhlim themselves are told this from the Ein Sof. They manifested from the infinity where everything could be possible. So you can call water the father of the plants, because from the water can grow the plants. So the ilas al-kali'ilos, he is the source of everything. He's the father of everything. He's the beginning of everything. Haine al yedei shatem oisem etzlechem lamata ish echod. If you unite, mizeh tishlechu mayim nukfen lechol eilom es mein tachles ad ein sof. Li is shom gam kem kebonim laviyem am oirim ma'anikim lo yed mechav oven. That through a person being meyachad himself, like we said before, that he recognizes the truth, he is mo'ir a cheshek in all of the world to go back to its source, to recognize its source. Because when a person forgets about the good, so he's meyayish from it. And then it doesn't have a cheshek to it even. It doesn't have any connection, doesn't have any shaykhis. And that's like a type of karas. The person's nichras from good. Like we see in Eicha, these type of expressions, like he's forgotten. He's completely forgotten what it means to have a good life, what it means to be in a good zone, what it means to be able to enjoy his day. People go through so much suffering that they forget, they're disconnected from it. So how do you make a person like that want it? When you show it to him, then slowly he starts remembering, he starts thinking about it, starts becoming warm, and then he has a cheshek. And this cheshek is extremely important spiritually, because the cheshek is the language of the spiritual. Through cheshek, that cheshek is the first step of manifestation. So first the person needs to have a desire, he needs to have a wanting, needs to have some type of lack. And through his lack, he starts manifesting. He starts going after what's going to be able to fulfill that lack. And this is called mayim nukfin. Just like by a female, that when she wants to be intimate, there's a certain change, a physiological change that shows that there's interest. The same thing when we want to eat, like we said before, the mouth represents reproduction. So when a person wants to eat, he starts salivating. His mouth starts becoming watery because there's a cheshek. He starts preparing himself for the food. That cheshek is spiritually is what attracts things to manifest, because the sikhlim are already here. They're all here and ready for manifestation. So what holds us from the sikhlim? What keeps us? What's the barrier? Why can't we go just higher and higher and higher, as high as we want? Because of our cheshek. So if our cheshek, let's say, is I want to have higher levels of perception. I want to go up the madrigas. I want to be closer to the yichud. But I also want X, Y, or Z. Now the cheshek is split into two. Half of it is pulling up and half of it is pulling down. And where is the person going to end up? Somewhere in between. Because his cheshek is pulling him in multiple directions. But when the cheshek is purified until there is only one thing that it wants, so then there's no stopping. There's no stopping that chayas from going up, from going higher, from going deeper. And this is one of the things that are holding back the geula, is that people have lost their cheshek for it. They don't even understand what's being discussed. So they need to have a demonstration of what it means to be nigel, of what it means to be a human being that's not enslaved, in order to even develop a cheshek for it, that they should even want it. Because if all of Klal Yisrael would have a cheshek for it, there'd be no stopping them. There'd be no stopping them. There's nothing that stops us from manifesting sikhlim other than ourselves, our own desires for other things. And the other things might be blockages for sikhlim. So if we want, like you said before, if a person has a rakhshtus and all his cheshek is in the physical, so then he loses access to his neshama. Not because his neshama wants to leave, but because he's tied himself spiritually downwards. And now the neshama can't speak to him. The seichel doesn't mean anything to him. But when his cheshek is upwards, when his cheshek is appropriate, then that's the driver. That's how we drive. Because from cheshek come thoughts, and from thoughts come diburim and come maisim, And it's only a matter of time until a person arrives to the location that he was trying to head out to. So the cheshek is like the fuel that drives a person, that pushes him. And therefore, it's our job to be ma'oder cheshek within this world to the yichud. Because that's what's going to bring it. That's what's going to bring it about when people will want it enough. וזהו כל נוסי בהם, היינו לכל הדברים וכל הבחינות שנמצא מעין ליש, וזה אוסי יש נוסי, it says the word נוסי could be rearranged and it could make עין and יש. There's only one יוד, but he's sharing the יוד between the עין and the יש. הכל נסעלו מזה ואילם לשושם ונעשה איש אחד בו מזה היטב. So it says that the נוסי, what's the נוסי? The נוסי is what raises people up, that a person, through raising up the יש, to the makom ayin, when the yesh wants, when the yesh yearns for the ayin, this raises up the whole reality. This puts us in a different world, in a different recognition, in a different place. And in that place, our ayin matches the original ayin. It matches the ayin that can actually reside within the yesh. And this is what's going to take place at the Gula Shleima, which will happen Meir B'Yameinu.